stuff. I mean, we're always like, don't spill your milk or, be careful. This is actually encouraging them to go out there and look for water to get rid of in their backyards or in their environments. So it's really a fun way of getting that message out there. So I'm not sure when. Oh, okay, we can, sure. It's a very short, I think it's about 30 seconds, but it's really fun. And this is something that was designed within the department.
Spill the water heaters. Stop your mosquitoes by spilling the water where mosquitoes are made.
They stop raining. Kids, do you want to see some of the boys out of the yard?
Hero suits activate. Invisibility bug spray. Apply. I spill the water hero knows. To save summer, you gotta spill the water. Here at that home, can you find the things around your warehouse that can hold water? Keep your summer free from mosquitoes.
So that's just one example. There are a number of materials that we've created for teachers to use so that there's the science portion lesson that's integrated into the messaging about mosquitoes. So we're really excited and thank you for the opportunity.
Well, this is the opportunity where everybody's going back to school.
Yes.
Can you talk about what
absolutely. I even have sheets. So, okay. Really, I just want to share about what we do in our community here in the County of St. John's. As a pediatrician by profession, naturally, the concerns with Zika virus and its link to microcephaly and other brain anomalies. It's particularly challenging for me and unsettling. And the reason is because this is the last time we actually had an infectious pathogen that actually caused the birth defects was over 50 years ago. With rubella, German measles. And then I wake up, and in my lifetime, we've got something like this from a mosquito. So it's like, as a pediatrician, what do you mean? This is not supposed to happen. So that's been a little bit of for me as a pediatrician, it's the real world, and I've got to understand this is the nature of what we're living with and how we live. But our county is the fifth fastest growing county in Northeast Florida. It's also the 15th fastest growing county in the nation. We have over 220,000 residents and about 6.8 million visitors a year. But these demographics do not get to what, in my humble opinion, makes St. John's County unique. What actually makes us unique is a truly integrated and collaborative community that is continually working together to ensure the health and safety of our residents and visitors. Now, this collaboration exists not just when we have an emerging public health issue, such as Zika or Ebola. The threat is our community, but it exists on an ongoing basis, allowing us as a county to not only leverage our resources, but our intellectual capital, so that we can actually be more optimal and meet the needs of our residents and visitors. So as one of the first counties in Northeast Florida to actually experience a travel-associated case of Zika, St. John's County Health Department activated our Zika Response Incident Management Team on February 5th of this year. And we have been conducting Zika response activities under our incident command system to this date. Now, I want to highlight a little bit of the collaborative spirit that has been evident here. As soon as we had our first case, our Board of County Commissioners and our County Administrator immediately offered us resources, including the support of the St. John's County Department of Emergency Management. Flagler Hospital immediately agreed to facilitate any needed Zika labs and work with us and our local providers to have a seamless type of process to ensure that it was as robust as we could make it. Our school district just recently also facilitated ability for epidemiological and nursing staff to meet with their teachers and school nurses to share the spill the water messaging. Anastasia Mosquito Control District is an integral part of our Zika Response Incident Management Team, and we have been in continuous daily collaboration with them. You are just the most awesome.
So far, expectations are high.
Awesome. Within the first few weeks of identifying our first travel-related Zika case, we held a committee partner meeting with key local officials and decision makers to inform and update all stakeholders of the emerging situation. And a few weeks ago, we completed our Zika response type of tabletop exercise in collaboration with St. John's County Emergency Management to identify capabilities within our local response system if and when and probably when, we actually experienced the local transmission of Zika virus disease in St. John's County. Surveillance of disease is what my expert committed and a dedicated team at the Department of Health in St. John's County does in public health, behind the scenes, each and every day, day in and a day out. We are actually available here 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. The safety and protection of Floridians and visitors in our community and state from Zika virus disease and other emerging public health threats is our mission that we take seriously as one of Florida's public safety agencies. As part of the integrated Florida Department of Health under the leadership of our State Surgeon General, Dr. Phillip, we have timely and coordinated support and expertise from the Division of Disease Control and Epidemiology at Central Office there in Tallahassee, so that we at the local level can do what we're trained to do and what we're best at doing. We understand that this is a fluid situation and look forward to learning more and following the science. This is a global society where every disease is just an airplane ride away. It is more apparent than ever the role of public health and the public health professional in keeping our communities safe. I happen to be very fortunate because I firmly believe that my team here is not only knowledgeable and talented, but incredibly dedicated. I have no doubt that we will continue to perform with excellence as we work together as a community to meet this current challenge. And in the interest of time, we did have my epidemiologist who was going to say a few words, and I don't know if you want to go there or can you leave the table.
That's fine.
Thank you.
Yeah, Joanna.
My name is Joanna. I'm one of the head of the epidemiology department here in St. John's County.
No, go ahead.
And she just wanted me to go over a few words to talk about what sorts of activities that we do. Unfortunately, mosquito-borne illness is not new to Florida. We do this every year, and we have been able to every year. I have conduct investigations on mosquito-borne illnesses such as dengue, malaria, chikungunya, West Nile virus.
And done a good job.
Yes, right? And it's mostly because of the people you see here. But we have done a good job. But it's with an integrated Department of Health and looking at the 67 counties and the lessons that we've learned from that I really feel puts us in a really good position to handle those latest things, Zika. Okay, so it's a new disease, but it's mosquito-borne, and we have the tools that we think that are needed for this. So once we get the disease, the communication, working with our state and our regionals, they keep us abreast of all the latest data and what's going on in other parts of the counties and Florida and the nation. And then from that, we get to our healthcare providers and we deal with them in our county. And we talk to them on a one-by-one basis, trying to get an idea about the suspect cases. And then we walk them through that. At the time when they think that they've got a case, we facilitate with the laboratory to make sure that we're getting tests and we're following the science to make sure that we're talking about which disease we're looking at. We concurrently work with mosquito control, who at the beginning of the investigation, all the way through the end and the follow-up surveillance period, to make sure that they're in the loop so that they can conduct the appropriate mosquito prevention activities throughout that time. Because sometimes it turns out to be flu or it turns out to be something else, but in which case we don't want to wait around for the results. Sometimes we want to make sure that we're responding to it in a timely fashion. And then we also work with WIC and Healthy Start and a lot of the other programs that have to do with our pregnant women, because this is a concern, and we want to make sure that we're responding to their questions and that they're getting all the answers that they need and to calm them. Make sure that they feel that they are in control. And then we have, even before the beginning of the summer, we coordinate with mosquito control to do an education outreach program. And through the partners at this table, they've helped me get into certain places to talk to school nurses, to talk to education from little kids to mature good kids in that regard, to talk about it. Because the biggest thing we can do is if we can get people to spill the water, we can get people to ask the questions, follow up with their doctor, they become empowered, and empowered people make educated choices. So I'd like to say thank you to everyone here for helping us out with that.
By the way, the state has done a really good job on chikungunya and dengue fever. I've really controlled the local transmission. I mean, all around the state, we have good county health departments and whoever's responsible for mosquito control, and it's different in every county. They do, they've done a good job. We've do well. Can we talk about what the mosquito board is doing?
Okay. It's the first case, February 5th.
Right.
Yeah, I was in someone American Mosquito Control Association meeting. Yeah, she called me. I said, okay, what? That's interesting. We quickly got back at February 12th, a meeting. So we have Department of Health and County and City, a lot of meetings. It was very, very nice, the cooperation. I was happy. Oh, Zika brought us together. But without Zika, maybe we don't have a chance together, work together. So we work very well. The interesting February 20, around the 20, we found the Aedes aegypti. This is the most sensitive vector for Zika. Yellow fever, dengue fever, chikungunya. Aedes albopictus, not the second vector. So far, not really many confirmed cells. Albopictus is number one. Still Aedes aegypti is number one. Most of that time, I worry about not Zika, I worry about the yellow fever. Have you been there in St. George's Street Disease Cemetery? You can see that many hundred years ago, many people died of yellow fever. That's the most I worry about that. And last year, the outbreak of yellow fever in Angola, even some countries, even in China. I was shot here. Yeah. So because we have a vaccine available, but nobody used it. Except you go into Africa, you get a shot.
I got it.
I went to five countries. Africa for malaria project, yeah. So the after that, we said, what can we do? We set it down. First that we need is, this species is very tough. The breeding, the container, we call it container breeding mosquito. Then we have that, that's a downtown. So we started that, divide the downtown to five parts, two technicians, to work for one rock. So every Wednesday or Thursday morning, the morning not many people tourists. We don't want to scare the tourists. Oh, Zika is back here. We don't want to scare the people. Yeah, so less number of people in the street. So we started cooperation with the city and even city just the mayor just left. She was walking with us. Our commissioner followed the walking street. Yeah, so we two people, street by street, door by door. This species only can do this. Yeah. The inspection. It was a surprise. We found that 80% of residents keep the bromine flower plant flower in their backyard, front yard, even in home. People didn't pay attention. People don't know that. So this is a big challenge. It's a bird feeding in your backyard. It's a container, are easy to see there. But it's for bromine, so inside a very small hold of water, mosquito. Then we started about almost 3 months. We are lucky. There's a second page, we have a beginning, we found a 9 location everywhere. It is aegypti. After we camping, street by street, door by door, currently we only found one spot. It's a Spanish colony, also behind that Fraga College. They interested under that basement, in the basement, underwater, some AC, drop water, hold water, lots of mosquitoes. That's the last week, I was lucky, found some place. Hopefully, that's the last place. But this is not only one time. We have to continue doing this kind of work. So only this downtown campaign, we over additional work, overspend about over $300,000. We have the mosquito label, door by door, one by one, you have to educate people, then clean up there. So that's the other thing that we're doing the suspect case. So far, we have 24 suspect cases. So that when we get the information from the Department of Health, we quickly set up people, set up a truck, the inspection around the neighborhood. Usually we make treatment within 1 mile diameter. Because the mosquito behavior not very far away, just within 1 mile, mostly 1 mile. So we have to increase education, increase inspection, also treatment, multiply treatment. We don't worry about overkill mosquito. So anytime, even if come back negative, we have a 24, 25 suspect cases, only 3 confirmed. Well, it's okay, let's kill more mosquitoes. It's why we're happy about that. So that's the two projects. Currently, we continue doing that kind of work. Hopefully, we get a write-off of Aedes aegypti from our county, from downtown St. Augustine. Other thing, we continue the suspect case and try to do our best effort to keep our people safe. I knew that we have a challenge, we have pressure because ours is tourist, ours is a city. Bring lots of tourists now. That's a big business. So that's our job. People pay for, we have to work hard to protect our people. So it's always a thank you, appreciate all everybody's support, and include our board and counting city and very, very supportive. This is when people cannot do anything. They have to teamwork together. Thank you, appreciate for your support. Yeah, we this year we Zika brought us always talking about the meeting. It's a very good support, yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you for coming to support this year.
But you expect everything seems to work well in St. John's County.
That's
what the superintendent always told me.
Yeah. From my 38 years experience, I don't expect too much hating from this county for a local problem. There's an 80-jib situation. But currently, the last week, I saw another publication about the Culex Queen's facilities. They're called the Southern House Mosquito, breeding in the stone drain. So some publication in Plus One, they said it's a laboratory sensitive. Our Brazil is tested acid the virus from there. That would be a bigger problem. So far, I cannot confirm about this. But it's still, we keep eye on it. So we look at what's happening. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for your hard work. By the way, your county health department always wins all the state.
Can we talk about what school districts are doing?
Sure. It's a perfect time to talk about that. Since about half of our school districts students will go back on Wednesday. Almost all the rest of the districts will start back this Monday. So this is a good time for us to just begin our focus on the spilling campaign and other things. I also want to thank Dr. Phillip. It's really just a great opportunity for us to be able to work together. And I'll tell everyone in the room that one of the things that's very important to the governor is that his state agency has worked together. We know one another, we have a good relationship, and he's fostered that. So this was not something that would have been strange for Dr. Phillip and I to pick up the phone and talk with one another and collaborate together and make a plan of how we can work together. I'll also tell you that I think it's a perfect example of government at work to help citizens. We often get bureaucratic, but this is an opportunity for us to be able to work together to make sure that all of our citizens are safe. So we have packets that are going to be ready to go for school districts so that superintendents can help their principals and their teachers and their students and their parent communities know exactly what to look for and as the mayor said, be reminded of what's going to be important for us to be doing. And the lessons that Dr. Phillip referenced, for those who might be concerned, you might be the only one in the room that is, and maybe Patrick Canan, is that they are aligned to the Florida standard. So it's a great opportunity, actually, for students, two birds. They get to be learning something that's aligned to our standards, and it's done in a way that's very real life. Students get to learn something practical. And so this is a great collaboration. I think it's a good opportunity for us to help our students be our best ambassadors, as Dr. Phillip mentioned before. They will also often bother their parents about doing the right thing when their parents...
Or grandparents,
as we would know. And so this is just a good opportunity. We are poised to do that. We've also got a great outreach effort, and within the department, we've all been working together on what are our groups that we work with on a regular basis to get the word out. So once everything is deployed, we will also do that with our other groups within the school system. We also feel very much that it's our responsibility to educate all of the public, not just those that are in public education, but we have outreach going to our private colleges, we have outreach going to all of our private K-12 schools in the state, so that they can be made aware, we're not just responsible for those that are in public school, but also for all of our citizens, so it's a great opportunity for us to do outreach and to bring the two sectors together to do so in a very meaningful way that everyone can then see exactly what we are doing and do what we need to in order to keep folks safe. And I can't help but be watching the Olympics and thinking about some of those Floridians coming back from Brazil into Florida and are needing to be prepared for that as well. So again, doing a good job of educating. We'll, if we don't already, we will have that video on our website as well.
Superintendent?
Well, I think we've worked together for a long time, and actually mosquito control has educational pieces that they've brought into our schools for years. They do a great job, a great presentation, and we work closely with them on the whole prevention side as well as the treatment side as we gear up for school. So I want to thank the commissioner and Department of Health for the materials. The quicker you can get those to us, the better. This is a good time, the beginning of the year, to start those educational pieces, and I'm delighted to hear they align with the standards, because that'll help keep our test scores where they belong. But more importantly, I think...
You don't bring that up?
I don't. You usually do. But we're excited about the Spill the Water campaign, and we will integrate that as quickly as we get those materials. And that PSA, if we can get that quickly, we can put that on our educational channel so that it can be shown, and as well as in our classrooms. And so we thanks to Chairman Canan, we modified our board policy regarding medications in school to where we can allow repellent now under the supervision of our school nurses for elementary schools. So we made that modification and that communication today to our parents. And we're fortunate that we have school nurses in each and every school, so we can work very closely with the Department of Health to deal with any issues that we might have and to help coordinate those educational pieces as well. And with that change in policy, maybe some education for some that might be concerned about chemicals, and so that we can get the right message out on chemicals, and so that we can communicate with our parents, and or at least be able to make the right links to where you can find out and feel safe, because you know, we've got 37,000 smiling faces coming Wednesday, and we want to make sure they get the right information home. Mr. Stewart's right. They do teach their parents, absolutely,
and grandparents
like me.
4.5-year-old.
Yes, they tell you exactly. You're wasting water there, or something else. So, anyway, I just thank all of you.
If I can also add, it is not unusual for local school districts to have that policy of repellent being medication, and so I think many districts around the state are looking at their policies to see about how they handle that and how they might be able to change their policies. So thank you for bringing that up.
So if we could offer a statement on safety,
yes,
that might be...
I think that would be helpful,
okay,
and we can include that as well.
Yes.
One of the things that we all can learn from each other are best practices, and so Miami-Dade College has a campus just a little less than 3 miles from the Wynwood area, and so I'll share with you that Miami-Dade College activated their crisis management team, began local conference calls working with local authorities, as well as informing and engaging students, ensuring that all of the college facilities were also making, you know, were being inspected to make sure that any water, sitting water that was standing there could be addressed by facilities, having the workforce in downtown and making those precautions as well. And so one of the things that we'll do is share with our 28 colleges the best practice that happened in the last few days at Miami-Dade College, and what they've learned from it in working with their local health department. I know here in St. Johns County, we have a great state college president working closely with all of you, but I think our colleges have just a long history of working with our health departments and local leadership, and as we say, you know, students that are informed will make good decisions, inform their parents and grandparents to make good decisions, but take the precaution. As you know, our college system has over 800,000 students enrolled, and they range from high school students that will be coming back next week to certainly our students who are expecting coming onto our college campuses. But all of our colleges do have in place emergency management systems, and they do activate those. I think that when we saw that in Miami-Dade, we saw the college lead with that. We'll be putting out all of the information from the department available to our colleges. Many of our colleges actually have high schools on the campuses, so that'll be distributed that way. And we'll be putting out information that comes out from Dr. Phillips on a regular basis with all of our colleges.
Thank you, Governor. On behalf of my board chair, Ms. Hancock, thank you for being here and frankly, raising awareness for this. Our classes will start about 10 days later than the public school system, so we have some time. What this event has done for me is, so tomorrow when I address the college council, it'll give me an opportunity to bring it up and talk to them about it. More importantly, when we have our faculty convocation, you know, the folks that really do see the students, you know, every day, we can make them aware of what they can do in the classroom. But what I think we're going to do more importantly is that I've found that, and as you know, our students, other than dual enrollment students, are adults. Some are young adults and some are not so young adults. Is engage our student government, or PTK, a student organization, to take this up as, on each of our three campuses in Putnam and Clay and St. John's, as a student activity, so that the communication certainly is directed by adults, but it's coming from students, and students are engaging students on what the precautions should be, what they should be looking for, those types of things. The spill video may be a little young for our students, but you know, talking about things like, bromeliads I didn't think of, but I did think of bird baths and things that people, where they deliberately have, you know, water that is kept in pool.
Inside and outside.
Right. Yep. So, the goal of, or my goal would be to engage students, and the more information we can receive and put in classrooms and put in student organizations' hands to help them spread the message is what we'd be looking for.
And we do have materials for the full age range. we wanted to be able to target kids or adolescents appropriately, so we're happy to share.
Available at each of our health departments in each of the three counties, or how does the administration access them to distribute to our group?
And we can
our
talk,
yes.
Yeah, we'll do distribution out to all of our colleges.
That'd be great.
Yeah. Thank you.
As well as make available repellent and other things on our campuses.
I got so excited with the PSA that I was remiss in my comments to share that we are in the process of getting enough repellent to share with each school, each university, which is a huge step, because you can obviously tell people to do something or recommend it, but if you give them that tool, the actual intervention, people are much more likely to use it. So we are in the process of making that happen, so thank you for reminding me.
Marcia, you want to talk about what the university system's doing?
Governor, thank you. One, I want to let you know that we are continuing to work with your office and also with the Department of Education, Department of Health, really to be sure that as we communicate to our students that we're going to be consistent, we're going to copy great ideas without reserve. If you don't mind, I'll give a shout out to Megan Collins. I think she didn't put this in my notes, but she's done an incredible job working with all of us to make sure that we're consistent. We have the pleasure of the fact that we just finished our summer semester. We had finals last week, so actually we have been working throughout the summer and communicating to our students, communicating to their families, and then we're preparing for the students as they return to campuses the next 2 to 3 weeks. I actually would observe, I think, that your PSA may go great with some of our university students, and we may start a whole new cultural persona on our, I'm thinking, I've been around a few of these students lately, and if Pokemon Go can go there, I think we're ready to spill out. But it is, and so from that side, our perspective is communicate, but work closely so that we're all, our students, our families, those who care about them are going to have that same message. I think we also have an opportunity through our boards of trustees to reach to the business community in Florida and make sure that our boards become part of that communication strategy. And we're talking to our community stakeholders, our community partners, and making sure that folks in Florida understand that our state is prepared. We know we've got a fall semester coming. One of my daughters will be going back as a sophomore, and I'm delighted she's doing it in the state of Florida. So we're in a good place.
And she can afford it in sales.
That's true.
Or you can afford it too.
Thank you, sir.
So do y'all
Yeah, thank you, Governor. Chris Schmidt, I'm the Chief Operating Officer at Flagler Hospital and also a clinician, and I just want to go back to 5
Very
February.
Good hospital.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. 5 February seems like yesterday with the first case. I think the one thing that's put us in a very good position is we were prepared with Ebola in the sense that we had so many dry runs and actual runs that this has become pretty much, I don't want to use the word no-brainer, but our staff are they're pretty much at the ready. The emergency staff, and this is the group that I would be more concerned with as we roll into a flu season and so forth, I could see a lot of worried well. So there's a lot of prep on behalf of the clinicians to know exactly what to be screening for. This is a question now asked, just like it was when we had the travel history with Ebola. And the education that comes from DOH, our Director of Infection Prevention, is working, you know, completely in tandem with Dr. Alacock and her crew to ensure that anytime an ER clinician or community physician reports up, the message gets communicated immediately, same with our lab, so that if we ever are doing it on site, we're ready. But as we send up specimens and so forth, you know, we'll be ready to go. The big push, I think, for us is number one, early detection, joining the education mission because of the number of folks that go through our hospital every day, and then also the treatment when it comes to that. A key focus is our maternal child care arena and making sure those clinicians and nurses are also ready to provide not only the physical but also the emotional support to through some of that. But as you all know, we're the only game in town, the only hospital in the county, so we've got a big task on our shoulders, but we're ready.
Done two calls that we organized with the CDC to healthcare providers around the state, and we're going to organize another call to just keep everybody informed. I mean, I think what everybody in healthcare will tell you that this is, they're learning more about this every day. So they're doing everything they can to keep people informed.
And our intent, too, with our CME, getting our medical staff together as this continues to progress, is pretty frequent messages to all of the medical staff so that they're hearing the same exact thing whether they're working in their office or they're working in the hospital.
Thank you, Governor. My name is Patrick Kanan. I've met you a few times, chairman of the school board, and that sounds like a broken record, but we have the smartest kids in the state for 8 years, so we will spill the water, no doubt about it. But as I'm listening, what I've become concerned about was I heard 6.8 million visitors, and this morning I read an article, and I don't know if it's true, I assume it was, that in Puerto Rico there's 8,000 confirmed cases and 1,000 a week, it's growing. And so as these people do come back from Rio, and we have such close proximity, obviously a territory, people visiting here has got to be one of our major concerns. Visiting the state, but certainly our county. And so I kind of think about our kids as it relates to that, and wondering what's happening, if there's anything that can be done about that, because it seems like that's how it's going to come here, is from people visiting.
We have met with our airport directors. We've had calls with our airport directors, same with our port directors, about doing everything they can to educate everybody that's coming through port or coming through the airport. We've talked to the individuals running our cruise ships, doing the same thing. But you know, we're a travel state. I mean, if people come here, we're going to have 110 million tourists hopefully this year plus. But with a good county health department, with good mosquito control, with a good education system, if we are doing the right things, if they do their job, plus every citizen gets rid of the water, wears the right clothes, wears a bug repellent, then this is something we can deal with. We've beaten, so far, chikungunya and dengue fever, and so we've stopped the travel-related cases of that. And so we're the biggest melting pot in the world. That's what we are. So I mean, that's not going to change. But you can tell that they've had an impact by what they've done. So we can do this if everybody's got to work on it. I was down, Dr. Phillip and I were down in the Keys, and the individual running the mosquito board down there says, I've got 76,000 people that I can engage, you know, the right way to help me. And that's, we have 200-some thousand people in this county. Mm-hmm. So, we're still going to have tourists. Right. It's 1.2 million jobs. I want all the tourists. All the government. My job. One of my many jobs.
Thank you, Governor. I came down today actually just to find out how many people would identify me as you and address me as Governor.
How'd you do?
Up to three. But I do, from the Board of County Commissioners, it is neat to watch the collaborative and cooperative effort that's put forward by all of our entities, both public and private. And I want to commend Dr. Alicott and the board that meets here, the advisory council that meets together, that all those, whether it be the school board, the sheriff's office, the mosquito control, to emergency operations, to Flagler Hospital and other private entities, all gather together, and it meets consistently, persistently, and it's actually effectual. Effectual works very effectual.
Your county works well together.
We actually have a really good working relationship, and it's nice to watch and to witness, because that's not the way it is in other places. And I'm grateful for it. I'm grateful for the work. These guys do a killer job. That's what I'll say. And then others are doing an awesome job too. And we work well together. The one thing that I'd like to bring up is in regard to the tourist industry. And one thing that we need to combat is sometimes perception. And all it takes is a perceptual event to deter people from coming to our state. This county. Main industry is tourism, like it is with the state, and that needs to be protected, and it is protected based on the very premise that you've done with education, capability, and a proactive approach. I appreciate it, Governor, for your efforts. I appreciate your efforts, likewise from both school board and from the Department of Health. Also, I'm really grateful for our private entities as well, especially Flagler Hospital. We have a business, an economic interest in this as well. It needs to be protected. And I appreciate your efforts in that and your recognition of that, because if not, it could be very, very, very destructive to our state as a whole. The last time we went through this recession, agriculture brought us out of it, and that's my business. We're not there anymore because of imported diseases that have destroyed our economy. And whether it be greening, or now we got a southern pine beetle, other things that are happening around this state that are happening that we need to be aware of and cognizant of. I'm appreciative of your efforts to protect it all. Thank you very much.
I think what you said is right. We've got to educate everybody. If we keep everybody informed, we can put things in perspective. If on the health side we do our job, and on the mosquito side we do our job, and then the rest of us constantly are educating everybody, Absolutely. I think that we're going to do fine. But we got to keep educating people. You got to tell people. And I was on a lot of TV last week. And this is 1 mile square radius in my area. And we have 20 million people live here, and 110 million people are visiting this year at least. So,
and it wasn't too long ago we had the Oriental fruit fly down there as well. It was 86 mile radius that a lot of people aren't aware of. That was very impactful on the economic interest that we have.
Yeah.
That thing spreads, we can end up in a real detriment. And I'm glad it's contained to 1 mile, and that's a blessing rather than 86.
So you have to keep it up. We have to
try.
No, I concur with Chairman Smith on our county that, we hear a lot around this table about education. Dr. Alicott, I'll have to throw out, 2-time Sterling Award winner, number one. We have a race between Miami-Dade and St. John's County, because we know we're really number one in a lot of things.
I like every county.
Yeah. That's right. I have to advocate. But it's interesting because our county, a big economic driver is education, and we're tackling this.
It really is for your county.
It is a huge economic
perception.
On the Board of County Commissioners, we recognize that. That is a huge economic driver, our education. And look at what we're tackling this problem with, education. Everything from we've got higher education all the way down to our kindergartners with the spill programs. It's indicative of our people, it's indicative of our elected officials, it's indicative of you driving home that these are, education is very important, and that goes all the way with our other industries and tourism. We want to take care of ourselves, and it's blocking and tackling. And all of this training that we've done to prepare for a moment like this, we're going to execute, and if everybody executes, we should be okay.
Thank you, Governor. So I just to echo your comments earlier. I think that with the diversity of students in the state college system, we have a lot of adults that we can mobilize to help carry the message as well. So whatever we can do to assist, I know President Pickens has already spoke to that, but we are just whatever we can do, because we have such a broad spectrum of people to help carry the message.
Well, if there's anything, Dr. Phillip, or I can be doing that you think we ought to be doing, or does it call us? So, I don't know if you want to add anything.
I just want to say that Dr. Hsu, I'm Gary Howell, chairman of the Mosquito Control Board. And Doc Shue had called me, and he was so excited about this Zika virus that he started speaking in Chinese. And had to slow him down just a little bit. But he has a tremendous program. Everybody's heard of the Fountain of Youth. We have a lot of mosquitoes there. We have a lot of tourists there. Downtown, we have a lot of tourists. So got together, myself and the rest of the commissioners and Dr. Shue, our educational specialist, and said, how can we whip this thing? So we put boots on the ground and started going, just like the mayor said, door to door. And we met in a little park close to her house. And they had an old fountain there that was defunct. And guess where we found mosquitoes? In her little fountain. So, but all of the people that work together, all the agencies, St. John's County, I hear this all around the room. And I've been here since 1948. Okay, on property for 45 years here in St. John's County. When I was a boy, we had a lot of mosquitoes. We had a lot of people that were not educated in mosquitoes. Today, the two things that we need to emphasize is education and eradication. Working together, I feel we have the best agencies in St. John's County. Working together, we're like a puzzle, and we all come together. We have a little bit of difference of opinion. We talked about that. But guess what? When it's time to get tough, we get tough, and we do what we need to do. And Governor, I want to thank you personally for having the initiative to tackle this thing head on. Put it out in the public and call in the right people to do the right jobs. We support you 100%. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. So what else? Anything else we ought to be doing that we're not? I can't solve any problems I don't hear about, so you got to be active.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Hey there, Governor. My name is Paul. I'm owner of Kingdom Management. We manage probably 100 homeowners associations, and that equates out to about...
All in St. John's?
St. John's County and Duval County.
And Duval.
And it equates out to about 30,000 units. And I just wanted to touch on a couple of things that maybe people are not thinking of. There's a lot of homeowners associations, particularly gated communities, that are self-sufficient. They do not have any interaction with any kind of government whatsoever. And the homeowners associations put most of the bill to all of the expenses for whatever utilities need to be taken care of in these communities. There's also a lot of communities that are 65 and older, whereas they don't have anything to do with children at all. They don't even want them in the community. So they
won't watch the video.
Thank you. They won't watch the video. And there's a lot of homes still in a lot of communities that are foreclosed homes, and they have pools in the back of these homes, and they have standing water. They're just sitting there, and banks don't even look at them, and nobody even else. They just make like they're not there. There's a lot of standing water in retention ponds and canals in a lot of these areas. And a long time ago, we used to see mosquito trucks come through the neighborhoods and do preventive spraying. And I'd like to know if there's any kind of preventive spraying that's going to be done in these communities. And if they're done in these homeowners associations, well, they're not going to have access to gated communities, and there are large swaths of areas that have gated communities, and they're not being touched by government at all. The standing water and retention ponds, is there some kind of something that can be done for these communities that have these retention ponds? There's a lot of canal systems going through particular areas where there's just standing water because the canals do not function as the way they're supposed to. That's basically things that I needed to touch on. We do have, I would say, probably 80% of the communities that we do manage, they all have websites. So if there's some kind of tool that we could, or information that we could get to those websites, that would be great. If you can get that down to us, we could get to that, to the community. I can tell you that I've been to a lot of board meetings where the public is coming to the Homeowners Association boards, and they're asking the boards, well, what is the Homeowners Association doing about this, and what kind of preventive measures are they taking? And they're concerned about the retention ponds and the canals and the state of the water and all that. And the best thing that Homeowners Associations can do is they put it back on the government side of the table, and you know, and then people walk away frustrated because the homeowners associations are not doing anything to have it. They don't have anything to do anything with. I was just reaching out to see what
you want to talk about with the mosquito board you're doing with regard to that.
Okay.
To introduce myself, my name is Christopher Bibbs. I'm the education specialist for the Anastasia Mosquito Control District, and this will require both answering for myself as well as the Department of Health, so I'll just answer the mosquito part. First off, there is, to my knowledge, there are very few HOAs within the county that do not allow us in. Those ones that do not allow us in have specifically written in their covenants not to allow us in, and this, like I said, is very, very few. We have a very good working relationship with a lot of the HOAs, but again, that's with the management side of the HOAs. A lot of the constituents may not be similarly aware, but I do make it a priority effort every summer that I work with a lot of the HOAs on a personal basis, especially our growing areas. Like lately, I've had a lot of involvement with Wilcox Village, Cascades, for example, all through Bartram Trail, Julington Creek, not all of the Nocatee area, especially because they lie on our upper buffer zone as it transitions into Duval. So we do make a lot of effort to be involved with a lot of them and to spread some of this education, as well as to make our services aware. A lot of them have been had very good questions and have been pretty engaged with what our services offer. I do want to clarify some that not all sources of water breed the culprit mosquito associated with our risk issues at the moment. Things like large retention ponds, canals, and other things, they breed very different sources of problems. So, for example, swamps and canal systems would breed West Nile vectors or malaria vectors, which, not to say they're not a priority, and we do treat those. But a lot of these campaigns and stuff are geared towards human refuse-generated sources of water, and sometimes not even in heavily manicured areas. For example, Palm Valley and Ponte Vedra can have just as many of these container breeding mosquitoes from the places you suspect leaks, ruts in truck beds, stoppered rain gutter systems, and even things like keels in the leaves of special types of imported plants and other things. And so we do try a lot, but also realize that we have limited resources, and so we get as fast as I can walk over there. As regarding other things such as standing water, we'll say like code enforcement type aspects in DEP, that would be something for DOH, so I'll pay for
that. That actually gets to our the Department of Health and Environmental Health, our environmental health divisions, because what we have is we have a responsibility if we get a complaint within 24 hours about standing water for situations that might be breeding mosquitoes and other bugs, that we have to go out within 24 hours and investigate. And then if it is true that those are situations that are breeding mosquitoes, that we then get back and we have to work with the homeowner, mosquito control, and code enforcement to have those situations abated. So there are different ways those can be abated. And they can be abated by getting back in touch with mosquito control and having the area sprayed. They can be abated by having what's called a dunk, which is a larvicide. Make sure I'm saying it right. Larvicide that's put into like a pool or an abandoned pool or for those houses that might be foreclosed. And those work for, I think, up to 6 months, I think, is that, or for several months?
Formulation.
See, that's the mosquito part. We deal with the people part. That's the mosquito part. But, you know, it can work for quite a while. And so sometimes people don't realize that those work for quite a while, and those pools may get the same call over and over for these houses. But we do go out within 24 hours when we have complaints about these situations. And we also work with the county works very close with us in code enforcement when we have those situations. So we do go out and investigate those all around the county to make sure that we do not have areas where we have mosquitoes breeding in our county for abandoned pools or standing water.
So if you have a meeting of people that manage all these, I'm sure they would be interested in coming in and making a presentation. And then if you get cards from them, you can call them. I'll tell you my experience, this is true with county government and state government. People want to do their job. Now, not everybody knows what they do often, but these people work hard. And so, but they'll be glad to come make a presentation.
Governor, I just want you to know that we have a proactive approach, not a reactive approach.
That's what I mean. You can tell from the
health department and mosquito control. together.
That's but if you have concerns, I would just get their cards and make a presentation.
Today we made a presentation, my team and Station Mosquito. Mm-hmm. Yes. Today we made a presentation to Civic on Table, which is a group of homeowner association.
Mm-hmm. This morning.
And that was just this morning. So if we're asked, absolutely. That's what we'd like to do.
That's great. Okay. Thanks.
Is that helpful?
Yeah. Very good.
Is anybody else in this? All right. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for what you're doing.
Standard of care right now during first trimester, second trimester. How to and then children who may experience some of these symptoms, what do they do?
Well, I
need to get through.
The index of suspicion. That's,
you need to get out of your way. That'll, I'm a better door than a window.
And I think now, we're hearing this right, anybody that's pregnant that wants the test is going to get the test. Yeah, going to get the test. That's what, that's, and should be covered.
This is big news. Hopefully it doesn't make it too big news here. That's the point.
Yeah, but you look at some relation.
I gotta get over
here. He'll come. Right about here.
Do you have, are you by yourself?
No, I can get that. Oh, she's okay. Just, I think she was trying to see. She's not here.
I'm just going to hold it for you. You're welcome. Mike, if you guys don't have to do that, I hold my phone anyway, so it's a way I can get a little bit of a workout in. Is everybody
I think we'll each say something real quick, and then we'll be open for questions. So Dr. Philip and I have traveled the state, and the whole goal is to, one, get ideas, find out what local needs are. As you know, we've allocated $26.2 million out of the state budget. It's through the Department of Health to help our local mosquito control efforts, help our Department of Health, help do education. We're still frustrated the federal government has not done more. Congress went on recess. We have asked for more Zika protection kits last week from the CDC. We went down to the Wynwood area. As a matter of fact, our Phillips spent down there a week and a half or something. Down there, we want to make sure all those businesses continue to do well. But we have, as you heard today, we have very good mosquito control efforts around the state. It's all organized a little bit different, county by county. Some counties we have through the county, sometimes we have it through a mosquito board. We're now in a position that school's starting again, so it's an opportunity to, one, educate all of our students, to help make sure their families are focused on no standing water, wear protective clothing, wear bug repellent, and the government's going to do their part. our county health departments are going to do their part, our surgeon generals did their part. So now it's the time for everybody, to, as they go back to school, to get informed. Now, Celeste, if you would like to add anything.
Sure. Ma'am, could we get your name?
Celeste Phillip. State Surgeon General, just in case. This meeting today was an opportunity to emphasize how important community partnerships are for Zika or any local health issues that arise. I want to emphasize that Florida has a long track record with mosquito-borne illnesses. We have a track record of success that we hope to continue. With the Zika virus, knowing that there are unprecedented impacts on developing fetuses and infants that affect their neurological development can result in microcephaly, which is the most extreme form, this raises our level of concern, and we are being very proactive in making sure that our prenatal providers are up to date on news information, that all pregnant women can come into a health department for a risk assessment and testing if necessary for Zika virus. Historically, we have seen what we call singleton cases oftentimes with mosquito-borne illnesses. So that means we'll see one case that is locally transmitted, but because of our coordination with mosquito control districts where they go out and start assessing the area around the residents immediately, we don't see ongoing transmission. We've seen that pattern with Zika, where we've had a couple of locations where we've seen an isolated case and no further transmission. The one area in Wynwood where we have seen multiple cases with evidence of ongoing transmission, we are being very aggressive with our efforts there. The Mosquito Control District is implementing a very robust, comprehensive plan to make sure that we disrupt transmission. As we test areas within that one-mile area and don't find any additional cases, we will make that information public so that people are aware of areas that we believe are clear of ongoing transmission as we work to make sure that transmission is disrupted. Our ability to partner with various entities, private and public, is an important part of our response. Today was an opportunity to talk about our collaboration with the Department of Education and university systems to share information appropriate for all members of our community to get the message out about spilling the water, which we are targeting to our youngest members, all the way up through university age and above, that we all have a responsibility to make sure that we get rid of standing water, that we use repellent, keep our skin covered, so that we are all doing our part.
Commissioner? I just think it's a great opportunity under Governor Scott's leadership and also the Surgeon General's leadership for us to work together and be able to make sure that all of our citizens are safe, and the Department of Education can play a role in that. All of our school districts are coming back within this week, and so it's a great opportunity to utilize all of the resources that are available and our educators to help our students and our communities understand what they can do, like spill the water and other things that they are able to do in order to be able to protect all of our citizens in the state of Florida. This is truly an opportunity for us all to work together, and I credit Governor Scott for bringing us together and helping us collaborate in this important effort.
Talk about what you're doing here with the
I'm Gary Howell. I'm the chairperson at the Anastasia Mosquito Control. Our objective is to serve and protect the citizens of St. Johns County. The governor's putting a team together. All the counties are working together. We work with the health department here in St. Johns County. One of our programs was to eradicate the larva, to go door to door in St. Augustine and around St. Johns County, getting rid of the larva before they become adults and spread the virus. We have a lot of tourists that come into St. Johns County in the city of St. Augustine, and our primary objective was to serve and protect those people. And if we do our job and every county does their job, our governor's program will be a success. And we thank him for being proactive governor. Thank you.
Talk about the state colleges.
Our colleges have a long history of working with our partners in K-12 with the Department of Health, and I think our colleges, again, locally really serve as a convening of being able to inform and engage students to take those preventive measures that we know are effective and that work. And so as all of our college students come back, nearly 813,000 across the entire state, all of our 28 colleges, and especially here in St. Johns County, will be working with our students to make sure that they have the best information available to them so that they can take the right action, take the right prevention, and inform their families.
The key and part of this is our county health departments, and St. John's County has a outstanding county health department.
Thank you, Governor Scott. I'm Dr. Dawn Alcock. I'm the Director and Health Officer with the Department of Health here in St. John's County. I do want to thank our governor here for bringing attention to our county. We live in a beautiful county, and a lot of what we do requires an incredible collaborative type of spirit. It takes a village, and what we have is a Department of Health at Central Office in Tallahassee under the auspices of my esteemed boss, State Surgeon General Dr. Celeste Phillip, who makes all this happen for us. Because of what they do at the state level, it enables us to do what we do best here. And they allow us to follow the science, and it's very important for us to understand it's a very fluid situation. We're learning every day. Actually, it's exciting. I'm a pediatrician by profession. What's exciting is the fact that, wow, today I give one set of information, tomorrow it's different. The challenge for us, as everybody's talking about, is that vulnerable population of pregnant female and women of childbearing age. That's a concern for us. It's a relatively mild disease, so if we did not have that anomaly, we would be saying, oh, we can handle this. We believe we're prepared because of our past experiences with dengue, for example, in two of our counties over the last few years, and we've been able to contain them, and we're containing them in Miami-Dade. We believe if we work together, as everybody has pointed out today, if we do our part, each and every one of us, and be as informed and as educated as we can be as individuals, we can do this. We can't stop everything. I don't think that's what we're looking to do, but we certainly can mitigate. And with the right support and our governor's leadership, we are here and ready to support and serve you. Thank you.
Answer any questions anybody has.
I'm talking about what you guys are doing for students in school. You have the plan, and I think I saw something about the Zika kit for teachers. Explain a little bit about what's going to be in that and how they can incorporate it into the curriculum.
Sure. It's information to be provided to our teachers so that they can inform their students, who very often then take that information home to their parents. And so we'll be providing that to districts within the next 24 hours. We're also working with the Department of Health with what else can be in that kit so that we can provide schools. And I think Dr. Phillip already shared that they'll be sharing repellent to all of our schools and colleges, and she may want to talk about that just a little bit more.
Sure. We are in the process of making sure that every school and university setting in the state will have repellent that can be given to students or those that enter the campus. So we think, along with the messaging, we are providing people with a tool. We're telling you to use repellent, and now here's a repellent, and it's been shown in other places to be effective when you couple the two together.
Have you been monitoring the weather? And because we're supposed to get
so much
rain.
Yes. Especially in the northern part of the state, we got rain again this weekend in Miami.
Yeah,
we're getting a lot of rain.
How does that impact the response in terms of mosquito control?
You can talk about mosquito control, but I can tell you what, every day, every citizen, I think about getting rid of the same.